salatu wassalam ala Rasulullah. Common sense and reason leads us and must inevitably lead us to believe that this universe has a creator, that there is one creator who is wise, powerful, and self-sufficient, that is different from the universe and the creation in which we live. And then we came to understand that when we looked at the world religions, all of them, in one manner or another, compromise this basic, commonsensical, reasonable belief, except Islam. Islam is the religion that teaches us this beautiful, pure monotheism that makes so much sense, that is so reasonable, and that is so close to the natural, instinctive understanding of the human being. But someone may have, after this, a question. Well, that's fine. That's a very nice belief. It makes a lot of sense. But anybody could come up with such a belief. In fact, maybe a person could argue that there are philosophers in the past who came up with a concept of God very, very close to that. Does that mean that what they said and what they did and what they followed was revelation and guidance from God? No, of course not. Because when it comes to the issue of revelation and guidance from God, we have to ask some more questions. Of course, the first one is, do we need revelation and guidance from God? Well, I think, again, when we apply our common sense, when we apply our reasoning faculties, then we will say yes. In fact, the human being is desperately in need of the wisdom and the guidance from the Supreme Being, from the wise creator of the heavens and the earth. In fact, we find that God has provided for us, Allah has provided for us, the Creator has provided for us in every single aspect of our life. We feel thirst and we have been provided with the means to satisfy our thirst. We feel hunger and we've been given the means to satisfy our hunger. We feel love and the need for companionship, and the means to satisfy that love has been given to us. So we find in all our material needs, even in our emotional needs, the provision and the means to satisfy those needs is there. But the human being has another need, a need that is perhaps even greater than the physical and emotional needs. And we have the need to know, what is the purpose of our life? Why are we here? What is the reason for our existence? And not only that, to know the purpose, but once we know the purpose, to know how do we fulfill that purpose. So there is something very precious, and that's to know the meaning of life. And there's something more precious, that once you know the meaning of life, you know how to live that life. So the human being has a great need for that. And it would not be irrational or illogical to expect that when we look and we see the condition of the human being, that the one who has created this universe and provided for us in all aspects must have also provided for us in this most needy of all aspects, this desperate need for us to know what is the purpose of our life, what is the reason for our existence, and how to fulfill that created purpose. Also, we would say that any human being who looks at this universe and observes the bounty that its creator has provided us with would also wish to express their gratitude and their love and their appreciation for such a beneficent and merciful and bountiful creator. But then the question is there, how do we do that? How do we express our gratitude in a way that is pleasing to God? What are the things that this creator wants us to do? What is the manner in which this creator wishes us to express our gratitude? This is another important question. Some people feel content that, well, I'll just do anything I feel like, or I can just guess. But no rational person and no thinking person would really be satisfied with that. Because again, when we go back to our premise and we think about ourselves and our everyday life and our common human experience, common human experience tells us that that is not a satisfactory manner or a satisfactory way in dealing with things at all. If you want to give your friend a present to show your appreciation, you won't just give your friend anything that you feel like and that makes you happy. You're going to make an effort to find out what your friend wants, what your friend likes. What sort of gift would they like to receive? Not what you want to give. This is just common sense. So even more then, when we want to thank the creator of the universe and express our awe and reverence and gratitude to God, we can't just do whatever we feel like, whatever happens to come to our mind, or whatever tradition or culture we just happen to follow. No. Rather, we need some guidance from God. The conclusion of all of that is, common sense tells us that we are in desperate need of some type of concrete guidance from our Creator. Some revelation, some guidance, some means that we could be sure and that we could understand and that we could know that this is the way God wants us to live our lives. This is the purpose for which God created us. This is how we could thank Him and express our gratitude to Him. Lots of people claim, in one way or another, to be bringing that guidance from God. Lots of people are claiming, I'm getting a message from God. I'm getting a revelation from God. God wants you to do this. God doesn't want you to do that. There's so many religions and so many people and so many sects and groups, and all of them are making essentially the same claim that they have some sort of divine guidance, some sort of guidance for you in which you're going to live your life in a way that is pleasing to God. But we have to use some sort of method to sort out, to understand. So again, let us use our reasoning process. Let us use our minds to come to this, to some sort of conclusion. It's very interesting, in fact, that the Quran, by the way, is the book of the Muslims. But it's not only the holy book of the Muslims. The Quran is what Muslims believe to be the actual words of God. The words of God, the speech of God that was revealed to God's final messenger, Muhammad, may God's peace and blessings be upon him, 1,400 years ago. The Quran actually gives a type of criterion, a type of means that the human being could use in order to distinguish something that is revelation and something that is from God against something that is a human invention. So the Quran gives forward a simple suggestion or a simple statement. If this book, the Quran, was from anyone else other than God, you would find within it many discrepancies, many contradictions. That's quite a simple, quite a rational, and quite a sensible proposition. If God is all-knowing, and if God is all-wise, and God is all-seeing, and God is all-hearing, certainly from our previous thinking and previous process, and looking at this universe and looking at this creation, we can definitely understand that the one who created this universe is very wise and very powerful. This creator is able to string together the molecules and atoms to form the chain of the DNA. The DNA that is the blueprint that makes creatures what they are. Could we imagine that such a creator who is able to bring into existence such a complicated system is not able to reveal a revelation that is consistent with itself without contradictions? No, surely such a wise and powerful being is more than able to reveal to human beings a book, a revelation that is free from contradictions, that is free from discrepancies. So this is a type of challenge that the Quran lays down, that we could apply not only to the Quran itself, but to any scripture or any book or any person who comes along claiming revelation and claiming guidance from God. How could a book 1,400 years old have information that was not known at that time at all by anybody and that has only been discovered recently? This is the sort of thing we would expect from a revelation that is from God. We would not expect a revelation from God to tell us that the earth is resting on an elephant which is standing on a tortoise which is swimming in the sea. This is the type of statement we would not expect to find in a book that's from God. This is a type of fairy tale, a type of fantasy story, a type of bedtime invention that some mother invented to tell their children. It's not something we could accept to be a revelation from God. For example, to take another example, the Bible. The Bible is a book that the Muslims believe contains some things that are from God. But we also believe that this is a book that has become corrupted and distorted throughout time. Firstly, the Bible does not exist in the original language of the people to whom it was revealed. This is the first stage of corruption. Secondly, things have been taken out and other things have been put in. So one of the very interesting things about the Bible is that when you read the very beginning of the Bible, it starts by telling us that God created the light and He called it day, and He created the darkness and He called it night, and the first day came and the first night came. Yet the Bible tells us that God did not create the sun until the fourth day. That begs a question to the rational inquiring mind. How did you get night and day without a sun? Now someone could say, well, God can do anything. That's not the point. We agree, God can do anything. But that's not the issue. The issue is this: does this scripture reflect reality? The one who wrote this, does this seem to be like the one who wrote this knew the processes that exist in this universe? That the night and day is caused by the alternation and the rotation of the earth on its axis? No. The one who wrote the Bible clearly did not know that this was the process through which the night and day occurred. They obviously imagined that there was some entity of light and some entity of darkness, and that light and darkness were caused by the existence of these entities. In fact, this was exactly the ancient Babylonian myth. So what we find is the Bible actually, rather than reflecting scientific fact, actually reflects ancient Babylonian mythology. And it would seem that the Bible, or not that there was an original Bible, that the true revelation of God was corrupted and changed in order to make it conform with these mythologies and these ideas that existed at the time. So we therefore cannot say that such a book is from God. Rather, because on the basis of what? On the rational basis, that this actually contradicts reality. These statements contradict reality. And that is a discrepancy. And we would not imagine that a book that is from God to contain such contradictions and to contain such discrepancies. But when we examine the Quran, when we look at the Quran, we find not only is the Quran consistent with itself and consistent with external realities, in fact the Quran is making statements that, as I mentioned before, scientists have only begun to discover recently. Statements about astronomy, statements about geology, statements about biology, statements on oceanography. In fact, so many fields of scientific discovery, the Quran is mentioning things that are amazing. Some of the top world scientists, how could this information be in a book 1,400 years old? And some of them have concluded quite rationally, quite sensibly, that it must be a revelation from the Creator of the heavens and the earth. So this is one manner in which we could decide and we could see whether a book is revelation or not. So first of all, the Quran calls us to this beautiful, pure, monotheistic belief, this rational belief that there is one God who has created everything and that God is different and distinct from the creation. Secondly, the Quran is consistent with itself. Now there is one more thing I want to look at. And the other aspect I want to look at is the messenger, the person to whom the revelation was given. Now there are many different ways we could imagine. There are many different ways we could imagine that God might let us know about Himself, how to thank Him, how to worship Him, how we should live our lives. There are many different ways. For example, this is just thinking and guessing and thinking, well, how could we, maybe, for example,